My name is Sukumaugi Skoin. I'm from Maskwatsisik. This particular bow is one of the four versions that we have within the Plains Cree people. All of these four versions, by the way, have to be tailored. All of the physics that go into it to make it bring down a buffalo very humanely. It would have to have all of these different types of things like precision, the snap of your arrow, your trajectory, different things that an expert bow maker has to take into consideration. Your first version is just a plain bow, and that's the wood itself, the plain wood itself. That one is called Intuachapi. All of the bows are called Achapi. Just like that word that it comes from this thunderbird, Piesiu. Waskai, then we say PSU itself is P, it comes from the word Pimatisuin, which is the life. And we call water Nipi, which is that derived from that word again, Nipi. And Nipi is water, Nia is me, and P is Pimatisuin, which means the life. And the creator calls himself, I am the life, Nipi, he's the giver of that. That water, so PSU derives again from Pisimwea P. See that P is in there again. Pisimwea P. It's part of that rainbow that we were talking about with that thunderbird, the water being. It's all of the etymologies are associated with that word, including the bow itself. So when you see a rainbow itself, it's like you're shooting that bow, and when you bring it into its full draw, it has that image of your half moon, kind of an arc. So that's that bead, and all of the words and derivatives are from that, all encompassed, incorporated into that, what we would term as the very affixed systems of oral tradition. And being so affixed within our oral tradition, we have what they call the history of creation story. And the etymology is such that it's kind of like a self-check-in system. Each one of those words have a very rightful place within its derivatives of each one of those words, of how we bring those together and make sure that it's like the flow of the story, for example, is very precise, including things like intonation and different things like that. But when we say ah-cha-pi, it's the bow itself we call ah-cha-pi. And even that, so that's part of that, you know, that Pisumwea P, that rainbow, but it's also that part is comes from Ahchak. So Ahchak is your soul. So that bow is your soul. According to how we receive the gift from the deities, as we would say, your second version is Astsachapi. Astsachapi is this is your sinew. You sinew, your sinew-backed bow. That's an attachment within that Intuachapi. The attachment part, of course, is your sinew and how they back it, utilizing different types of methods of how you would glue it onto the back of the bow to take into different things like I say, your trajectory of your arrow, or maybe other things, maybe speed, precision, or different things. And that's how you account for when you very specifically, minutely, the way of how you place your sinew in order to make that tailored shot that you need to make. And that's your own, of course. When we say Ahchapi, that's your soul, Ahchapi. That's a part of you. So when you ask a bow maker to make a bow for you, you have to be there as part of that process where they would incorporate you, your size, your everything within you, your even the style of how you shoot, whether you're shooting a pull style or you're shooting a push style or a mixture of both. And he has to determine all of the things, that qualities, that characteristics that you have of what's going to make that bow a part of you. And then your third model is this model here. So this one is Sipaikan. Sipaikan Nachapi. Sipaikan means a backing. It's a wood backing. It's also a layered wood backing. The backing is made of specific types of woods. We're a very nomadic people. We're bartered and traded with different bow woods throughout North America. One of them, well, just an example of our who we were, Morley. The word Morley itself, Morley, Alberta, the word Morley itself, we call it Manahchapanik. Manahchapanik means the place where you obtain prime bow wood. And they find it in different elevations and these different types of bow woods that they go after. Whether it's standing, you know, wood that maybe standing burnt wood, maybe all different types of species of different forms of wood that they find there to in turn trade for other woods. Like say in southern United States, we have a Osage orange wood there. They call it the bodark. There's different other names for that species. It has a very, I guess you could say, tensile elasticity to that wood, where we can actually put it on the outside of that bow itself, for the layered bow of this particular version here. We can actually glue it onto the outside. Because of its stretch, it's able to withstand that stretch. And the interior, being the wood to the west of us, they have a wood that's more able to withstand what they call the pressure of compression, you know, within that, the compression forces. And then we have to have woods that are in between that too, that are able to have a balance of both, that kind of a thing. So what we do is we actually get our sheets with this one. We would get our sheets from sometimes living trees, as well as burnt trees, you know. But the ones in the living trees are the easiest to get. Of course, they're all kind of hard, you know, like especially in the winter time. So what you do is you precision mark your the exact amount of bow, that strip that you want, whether it's say an inch and a half, an inch and three quarter strip that you want a piece, and you mark it all the way down. And then what you have to do is you have to V wedge it. It's an interior V wedge, and you can use your the bark. You're cutting into the barks when you're actually doing the mark, the initial precision mark. You're leaving that, you're leaving the outer barks. You can use that outer bark as your measuring device for you when you actually go into chiseling it out, utilizing a really sharp tools like us we call pepegahagan. Pepegahagan in our language is obsidian. It's the sharpest object in the world. They use it, doctors use it. It's sharper than needle points. But that's just a little bit about the type of a bow this is and how we, you know, obtain those strips of wood. And there's a fourth wood, and that one is, they call it iskanachapi, which is the horn bow. It's a either elk horn bow or ram horn bow. You mix here, you put it, you use the wood as part of the bow itself. So attachment of the wood and the horn itself. So these are the four models that we have, and they're all they're called achapi at the end. So in tochapi, and they call aschachapi, sipaikanachapi, and eskanachapi. So those are the four bows that we have within our culture. So just giving you a little bit of insight as to some of the things that, you know, go into it. There's a lot more detail, and of course in all of those bows, in the seasoning and what have you, and even the different types of when you actually, you can get it at any time, any season, but there's actually each time there you get it from a different part of the season, there's a way that you treat the bow in order to get it to its final stage. So thank you very much for giving me a little bit of your time to explain a little bit of our bows here. And so anyway, we have a particular name for this one, and we say we ask us that. That's kind of like the bow that puts meat on the table kind of thing, and we ask us that. That's what this one is called. So thank you again very much. Really appreciate it.